Hello and welcome to the last episode in the first series of Bakul Talks. So as many of you probably know that we started Bakul Talks in October, soon after the Nobel Prizes were announced. And we thought, why not have the first series on the Nobel Prizes itself? Because the idea behind Bakul Talks was to have a series of public lectures which would be interesting and engaging to any curious individual, irrespective of his or her disciplinary background. You know, unfortunately, I'm a student of literature. I will not read up or try to know anything about medicine or anything about physics, chemistry, etc., and vice versa. Okay, which is unfortunate because it's all in the realm of knowledge, and we all should have, you know, a curiosity to know about other things, at least the things that matter a lot. And the Nobel Prizes, with all the problems, I mean, in the earlier sessions where we talked about the other Nobel Prizes, we talked about controversies, we talked about work that deserved a Nobel Prize but could not get, for example, Gandhiji never got a Nobel Prize for peace, right? Similarly, Einstein never got for the theory of relativity, okay? But given all that, with all those problems, still, it is a recognition of significant impact on the world and on mankind. And that is why we thought, why not have a series of talks for the general audience, you know, for anyone, and which would be insightful to intellectuals, but at the same time, intelligible and interesting to teenagers. Okay. And I think we're very happy that we started with the Nobel Prizes. Now, when the idea had come, and the idea had come earlier also, and we started this Bakul Talks. So the first speaker that I was sure of is actually now our last speaker in the series, Dr. Sujata Kar. Now, she is someone I knew as a, because she has been our doctor for my family, my parents, my wife, and us. But more importantly than that, you know, she used to keep sending me videos on for public awareness on different medical issues. And I love the way, you know, so she was a vlogger, a YouTube blogger, you know, as we all say. And she used to make it very interesting and simple in a way to make us understand and to, you know, for awareness and action. And so when we thought about, you know, whom to have, because we wanted to have the best people in the country for that, you know, we are, you know, based in the in Bhubaneswar at the Bakul Library here. But as those of you who've seen our programs know that we think big, you know, whether it is our storytelling programs, which happen every Saturday and Sunday. In case you are joining us for the first time, every Saturday we take children, you know, primarily small children, to virtually tour a different country with one of the best professional storytellers from that country. That happens live at 9 p.m. on our Bakul platforms on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter. This Saturday we are traveling to Lebanon, you know, the country of the hummus, shawarma. Now, Dr. Sujata Kar is very fond of cooking. I know that. So I'm sure she will be thinking about Lebanese food when, and she's fond of traveling also. But that's something we can talk about when we have the question and answer session. And every Sunday, of course, we have Rabibar, Gappobar. But so these sessions have been happening. Similarly, in Bakul Talks, we had the country director of the World Food Program, which won the Nobel Peace Prize. We had a professor from IIM Ahmedabad, one of the finest poets, for the Literature Prize. But as I said, when I thought about which speakers to have, now many of these people I didn't know, okay, but I was sure about one person that I definitely wanted, and that was Dr. Sujata Kar, because not only is she a very eminent doctor, I mean, many of you who are watching this show definitely know her, you know, very eminent gynecologist based in Odisha, and, you know, the force behind Kara Hospital. But more than that, you know, when I asked for her profile and she sent me and said that, you know, it says she had won 7 gold medals when she was a student. I thought, where were the opportunities for so many medals? So that means virtually that she must have won every medal there was to get. And I'm sure all her friends, all her, you know, peers must have been so envious of her. But anyway, that is not the thing that we want to talk about. So she had been a brilliant student and a brilliant doctor. But more than that, as I said, we thought we cannot have a better person than her, not only because she's so articulate, but because she's so wonderful in communicating complex medical issues to simple, you know, in a language that people like me can understand. Now, let me tell you something. I am someone who runs away from doctors. But Dr. Kar is one person who makes me feel like wanting to go to her. I'll just tell you a joke. So I once went to a doctor and he, you know, asked me, I am an atheist. I don't believe in God. Why should I go to a temple? He was basically commenting on me. He said that you don't believe in doctors. Why are you coming to me? So I am that kind of a person. But Dr. Sujata Kar is someone who reassures you, you know, with her presence and who gives you that confidence to want to go to her to talk about your problems. And she is someone I turn to talk about the Nobel Prize in Medicine. And she is the first person I ask. And she has been the most accommodative, you know, in terms of the most flexible in terms of the dates. Okay, some other speaker is not having this date comfortable. Fine, I'll shift, right? So the best person over to her to talk about the Nobel Prize in Medicine for 2020 and the Nobel Prize in Medicine in general. Over to you, Dr. Kar.
Good evening, viewers. Good evening, Sujit. And to all your members and team in Bakul Library. Thank you very much for such a wonderful introduction. I don't know how much of it I deserve, but it was really sweet of you to have these little observations that you've made and to talk about them. Where the gold medals are concerned, you know, there's something I must tell. It's, you know, generally one doesn't have to win gold medals to be a good doctor. It's good if you have it. I was a very studious kind of a person in college and school career. So, you know, the typical boring studious type. To be a good doctor, you don't need to get so many medals and so many of these things. You just need to be empathetic, and you need to be connect with the patient. Treatment, there is not too many treatments that you can offer for human diseases. It's more of a compassion that works being a doctor. So thank you once again for this introduction. And so should we get ahead with our presentation? Should I share my screen? Am I there with my presentation?
Yes, yes. Yeah, please carry on.
Yeah. No, I was just waiting for you to answer. Okay. So, when Sujit said that, Dr. Sujata, would you like to talk about Nobel Prizes in Medicine? I kind of, you know, thought that why me? Because the this year's Nobel Prize on Hepatitis B, and I was like, you know, hoping that it would be something of my subject. Had you asked me to speak in 2010 on Nobel Prize of Medicine, which was an IVF, I could have talked endlessly. And had you even asked me this year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry, which was on, genome editing, I could have talked endlessly because that is my topic. So I thought, how can I, you know, generally contribute to your lovely program that you're having? So Nobel Prize in Medicine, that's why today what I'm going to cover is give your viewers, today our viewers, a kind of a overview of the Nobel Prizes in Medicine over the years since 1901, and tell you about some facts, some fun facts, and some interesting things which you would not know, and some interesting Nobel Prizes which have changed completely the practice of medicine and which have become a household name today. And in the end, of course, we will talk a bit about quite a bit about hepatitis C, for which this year's Nobel Prize in Medicine has been awarded. So the Nobel Prizes in Medicine is given to discoveries in medicine on physiology that leads to benefit of humankind on in general. So a little bit about the medal. The medal was planned by Eric Lindberg. It is a medal which has 23 carat gold, 200 grams. In addition to this medal, there is a 4.5 crore cash prize for each of the winners. In all the medals, I believe, have different inscriptions on them. On one side is the face of the Alfred Nobel, the one who installed these prizes. And in the medicine medal, there is the genius of medicine, who is holding an open book in her lap and collecting the water pouring out from a rock in order to quench the sick girl's thirst. So this is what is represented in the medal, which is given for medicine. Now, over the years, which is from 1901 to 2020, in 119 years, Nobel Prize in Medicine has been awarded 111 times to 222 Nobel laureates. And you may be, I don't know if how many you're aware or not, but maximum 3 people can only receive one award. Usually nowadays, more number of people are getting awarded. I think that is because so many places, countries and continents are doing research, cutting edge research. And usually multiple people have to do research in multiple areas for it to have a particular significance. However, earlier on, there were 59 people who received the Nobel Prize in the first 50 years in the last century, while 113 individuals received it between 51 and 2000. So this is what I was saying, that in earlier years, in the first 50, 60 years, just one or two people used to receive the award. But over the years, more and more number of people are getting awarded for one particular topic. And so more number of people are getting the awards. The only Indian who won the Nobel Prize in Medicine was actually an Indian-American, Hargobind Khurana. He did his all basic studies in India. He belonged to Raipur, a village in Punjab. And he was a biochemist who won this award for constituting or for coming out with the genetic code. All 64 possible triplet coding units, codons, along with another American biochemist, Marshall Nirenberg. So this detection of the genetic code had great importance, because you may be knowing that DNA was discovered by Watson and Crick. And they got a Nobel Prize, I think, for it sometime in 1960s or sometime, I don't remember very well. But DNA was the single most important discovery. And now DNA is important for everything, whether it is for medicine, it is for catching criminals, or for anything. DNA is such an important discovery. And that is how science and medicine has advanced so much further. Now, this genetic code that they discovered was also another very important discovery, because you all are aware that there is so much variability, phenotypic variability, in all the species that we have in the globe, in the world. So many species of plants and animals, and they are so different in appearance. I mean, we all appreciate that. There are millions and millions of species. However, there are the genetic code, the recipe of the genes that creates a life is very, very similar in all the organisms. It has just 64 codons that can code or create the recipe for each species that we see in the entire world. So this genetic code is so similar amongst organisms, and that is also one of the reasons why many people believe that probably the life on Earth was not as a result of evolution, typical Darwinian theory, but life on Earth was seeded from elsewhere, because it appears to be so complex from the outside, yet to create it, the code appears to be so simple. You just need 4 base pairs, G, C, U, A, 2, and T, the various base pairs of amino acids that form life. So this discovery by an Indian, Hargobind Khurana, was a very, very important part in furthering medicine. And this was a great advancement in medicine. Now, women in Nobel Prize. Before talking about women who have got it in medicine, it's interesting to note that from 1901 till 2020, only 58 women have been awarded the Nobel Prize. Earlier, in first 20 years, just 4 women, gradually increased. But in the last 20 years, 2001 to 2020, 28 women have got the Nobel Prize. So you can imagine that the role of women in advancing science is tremendously increasing, and it is only going to go up, as you see. So as of 2020 October, 4 women have won so far in physics, 7 in chemistry, 12 in medicine, 15 in literature, and 17 in Nobel Prize. So this was about women, and you can see that a large number of women compared to other subjects have got it in medicine or physiology, like, understandable. Now, there were 5 years when the Nobel Prize was not awarded. Interestingly, from 1915 to 1918 and again in 1921, can you guess why this would be so? If you can't, this was the time in which World War I was being fought, and a war and politics and poverty, generally, even this was the time of the Spanish flu, the 1918 and 1919 Spanish flu. So there was so much of disorder in the world, so much of pain, war, etc. going on, that I'm sure creativity and research and science got a backhand. And so Nobel Prizes were not awarded in these 5 years. Some milestone Nobels in medicine. Everybody knows about insulin. This was awarded to Sir Banting, and many of you must have heard this word, Banting and Best, 1923. Today, insulin is the mainstay of treatment of diabetes. And as you know, diabetes is a lifestyle disease, and diabetes is like, India is, for your information, the world capital of diabetes at this time. I think we have every 4th person being diabetic, and insulin, the discovery of insulin has gone a long way in understanding carbohydrate metabolism in the human body, and therefore to be able to treat conditions like type 1, type 2 diabetes. The other one is ECG, which was awarded to Eindhoven in 1924. Can you imagine a hospital, a doctor, a medicine specialist working without an electrocardiogram? It's you know, you can't think, it's like your almost like your right hand now, electrocardiogram. So that was another groundbreaking Nobel. Then 1913, Karl Landsteiner of Austria got his Nobel for the discovery of human blood groups. Now again, blood groups is something which we take for granted. It's just part of us, and it's unbelievable that it's just 90 years that blood groups were discovered, and today blood group related diseases, treatment of blood group related diseases, blood transfusions and saving lives has become an integral part of everybody's life, not only medicine. And there are people who so voluntarily donate blood, etc. So it's part of our life. Now, there are 2 diseases for which Nobel Prize was awarded. Ronald Ross in 1902 for malaria, and Robert Koch in 1905 for tuberculosis. You can imagine it's been almost 120 years since the discovery of malaria, tuberculosis, and eventually the treatment of malaria and tuberculosis. Yet you all are aware that we are struggling with the treatment and eradication of malaria and tuberculosis. Polio could be eradicated, smallpox could be eradicated, but malaria and tuberculosis till now has not been able to be eradicated. And there are countries, third world countries or developing countries, India is struggling with tuberculosis and malaria. There are millions of hundreds of deaths What do you think could be the reason? Medicine has found the cause. Medicine has found the details of how it is transmitted. Medicine has found the treatment, yet it is not being... In my mind, I may not be absolutely correct, but in my mind, it is a politics of poverty, politics of development, which has prevented mass major killers like malaria and tuberculosis from being eradicated from the world. But I am open to, you know, ideas. Then was Alexander Fleming, another very well-known name. He and other two others got for the discovery of penicillin in 1945. Penicillin, as you know, was one of the antibiotics first discovered for various infectious diseases. And for years, penicillin was the mainstay of treatment of so many bacterial infection, including syphilis and many other, diseases. And that was the, the basic point of discovery from where on. Medicine has come a long way in discovering multiple antibiotics and antifungals and antiprotozoals, etc., and treating so many of the infectious diseases. In fact, so much so that in developed countries, infectious diseases have taken a second, importance, and other diseases have taken over. Now, another important one was a CT scan, computer-assisted tomography, 1979. Alan Cormack and Godfrey Hounsfield of South Africa and United Kingdom. Now, CT scan also is a word which I think majority of lay people have also heard of it. It is one of the very, very important methods of detecting or diagnosing various diseases in the human body, whether it is benign conditions or whether it is malignant conditions or it is injuries in the brain and other things. It is one of the very, very important discoveries that has changed human life and changed the practice of medicine over the year. In 1990, organ and cell transplantation. Can you imagine today kidney transplant is an everyday occurrence? It's so common. Cornea transplant, which has given vision to so many people. Kidney transplant has given life to so many people. And if you go much deeper, lesser known, but heart transplant, liver transplant, lung transplant, even face transplant. So transplantation medicine is a big thing today. And it is all thanks to understanding of organ transplantation by these two Nobel laureates of the United States, for which they were given the Nobel Prize in 1990. So cell transplant was organ transplant was a very important part. Then 2003, again, two more Nobel laureates got it for their discovery regarding magnetic resonance imaging, which is MRI. MRI is, many of you may not be knowing too much. It's not as common a word as a CT scan. But the two are, very, very different. The CT scan depends on X radiations, X-rays, to image your body. So if you go through a single CT scan, you are like exposing your body to close to equivalent of maybe 2000 chest x-rays. So it's exposing your body and your body cells and your organs to x-rays, which are known to be harmful above a certain dosage. But magnetic resonance imaging is based on a different technology. It is based on magnetic field. So you need huge magnets, creates a magnetic, I am also again not very clear, on the fundamentals of the imaging technique, but it depends on creating a magnetic field, and based on that, it images extremely high fidelity imaging of the body and its organs and its soft tissues, bones. So this is another excellent advancement in imaging, which has helped in treating so many conditions. Now, 2010, Robert Edwards got for the development of in vitro fertilization. Now, in vitro fertilization is my area. I am one of the first people to be doing in vitro fertilization in Orissa. So in vitro fertilization is a which first started in 1978. So you can imagine that this person, Dr. Sir Robert Edwards, got the Nobel in for this discovery almost 38 years after the discovery of this technique. So when it was first performed in, and the first birth of Lewis Brown, who was the world's first test tube baby in the United Kingdom, he along with Stephen Patrick Streptow, Patrick Streptow was the gynecologist, Robert Edward was the physiologist. Together, they are credited with the development of in vitro fertilization technique and for the first test tube baby of the world. But 38 years later, they got. By that time, Streptow was already dead. And the Nobel Prizes have a policy that it cannot be awarded posthumously. So only Sir Robert Edwards was given 38 years after development of in vitro fertilization. Now, why was that? Because you've known the philosophy behind awarding the Nobel Prizes in medicine. It has to do good to mankind. In vitro fertilization, when it was first discovered, faced a lot of resistance. Criticism, whether it was from conservatives, conservative Christian groups, similar, who thought that this was like simply unacceptable, that a creation which is meant for God to be doing inside the human body will be done outside, and then a human being will be formed or born out of this technology is simply unacceptable. So they faced resistance from multiple angles, even from their peers, who at that time would argue that the world is facing problems of population growth, and nobody is interested in vitro fertilization, and infertility also was not considered as a big problem like it is today. Today, infertility is a huge problem, and fertility or the right to have your own child is regarded as one of your basic rights, which was not recognized in those times. So today, or let's say in 2010, 4 million babies. Today in 2020, I think the statistics say something like 8 million babies worldwide are already born out of in vitro. So in 2010, when it had become huge and a large number of, let's say about 10% of population who was suffering from infertility, out of which a sizable chunk needed in vitro fertilization to have their own child. And so the world, or let's say the Nobel Committee or the medical profession, whoever, woke up to the fact that, okay, this is a very important discovery. And so better late than never. And Sir Robert Edward was awarded this Nobel Prize. I think 3 years later, he died in 2013. So this was one, from the point of view of gynecologists like me, who practice IVF on a day-to-day basis. And so many infertile couples have benefited from this technology, was awarded 38 years after it was discovered. So that was a bit about some of the life-changing or paradigm-changing or society-changing Nobel Prizes in medicine. Now let's come to our point of interest for which I am here today, which is the Nobel Prizes in Medicine for 2020. So the Nobel Prizes this year was awarded to three scientists who have made a decisive contribution to the fight against blood-borne hepatitis, a major global health problem that causes cirrhosis and liver cancer to people around the world. Now, the three people who won this were Harvey Alter from the United States, Michael Hutton from United Kingdom, and Charles M. Rice from the United States. A little about hepatitis C. Now, hepatitis C has been a plague and still is. So, as of now, I believe more than 70 million cases globally are suffering from hepatitis C. there are close to about 4 lakh deaths per year, and this is a common cause for liver transplant. So this is a big public health issue. There is no doubt about it. Now, this is a kind of a virus, the hepatitis C. Viral hepatitis or viruses that cause lung disease, liver disease or liver infection are broadly, majorly of 3 categories, hepatitis A, B and C. Hepatitis A is the jaundice that you all know, for the lay people, hepatitis A, which is the infective hepatitis, it is called. It is called by a virus called hepatitis A virus. And it is very common. Like you get it from the bad food or the infected water, or, you know, eating gupchups and chaats and all that outside. And basically, usually it's a mild disease. It's self-limiting, causes little jaundice, a fever, etc., and liver enlargement, and the doctor treats. And usually it becomes all right. And the good thing is that it usually does not have a long-term sequelae. The other two kinds of hepatitis are hepatitis B and hepatitis C. Now, these two viruses are transmitted by blood. So, it is not very common in the general population. Who suffer from it? Those who get blood transfusion, medical professionals, those who get, you can get it in injection series, injections from an infected series. You can get it in a hospital if you undergo some kind of a procedure in which blood barrier has been broken and you are infected for some reason inadvertently. Doctors who are operating on patients who are having hepatitis B or C, and if they have a, you know, kind of a skin breach, they can get it. So medical professionals, people undergoing medical procedures, and drug addicts, those who are onto IV medications, drugs and things like that. Also, this is a possibility of getting the hepatitis B and C. Now, the problem with hepatitis B and C is that it is a chronic illness. And on a being chronic, over the years, it can develop chronic hepatitis. Like, it doesn't go away, it stays in your body, it damages liver cells and continues to damage liver cells, and the person suffering from it becomes infective to other people who are exposed to that person's blood. Then over the years it leads to cirrhosis, which means the liver becomes fibrotic, stops functioning gradually, and then it can also progress to hepatocellular carcinoma, which is a cancer of the liver. And as I mentioned earlier, hepatitis C is one of the commonest causes of people who need a liver transplant. Now, when we used to, for me, for a surgeon, why it is important, hepatitis B and C is, sorry for this spelling mistake. So why it is common important for us is, every patient I touch, every patient I operate, every patient I deliver, I will check them for hepatitis B and hepatitis C, not for hepatitis A. Now, I will check them. Why? Because if I operate on them, I'm touching their blood. And if I have a skin breach, which is, let's say, even microscopic in my hands or in through my cornea or, you know, through other epithelia, I can get infected from the patient. So it is common practice for all doctors to test their patients or to screen their patients for hepatitis A and hepatitis B and hepatitis C. Hepatitis B has been known for a pretty long time. Hepatitis B vaccine we have and we've been taking. So as a surgeon or as a medical professional, you continue at regular intervals, you have to be immunized against hepatitis B. Now, that's not true for hepatitis C. Since 1976 that we've been operating, we have known that even if you have tested for hepatitis B, there is some kind of a blood-borne hepatitis which one can get hepatitis, which can affect us through the blood of an infected patient. And we did not know what that was. We only knew that in spite of getting tested for hepatitis B, there is some hepatitis which is affecting. So for a long time, we used to call it hepatitis non-A, non-B. It is only very recently that it is being called hepatitis C. And it is also very, very recently, maybe 10 years or so, we have a screening test. So it's just about 10 years or maybe even less, I can't remember properly, that we have also got a test to check our patients for hepatitis C. So this year's discovery is very, very important from the point of view of this major disease. Now, three people were awarded for three different reasons, but all three taken together have a major impact on the disease outcome. So let me just read this out. The Harvey, what he did, the methodical studies of transfusion-associated hepatitis by Harvey demonstrated that an unknown virus was a common cause of chronic hepatitis. This guy detected that there was something. And actually, we have been knowing this. We used to call it hepatitis non-A, non-B for many years. We didn't know what that was. So this guy was responsible for knowing that, okay, there is some kind of a chronic hepatitis in the blood samples of some patients that can cause a chronic hepatitis. Now, the other guy, Michael Hutton, he isolated he created antibodies against that agent and called it hepatitis C virus. The virus was not isolated. He created the antibodies against it so that we could at least check. We could check that, okay, does this blood have respond to this antibodies? So this was the second person who did a great part, played a great part in the role in the discovery. And then Charles M. Rice, very recently, he provided the final evidence, the final clue that showed that this is the virus, and he could isolate the virus, the hepatitis C virus. And so today we not only have sensitive hepatitis C virus tests because of the second person's discovery, we have effective antiviral drugs also to some extent. And I am sure over a couple of years, we will also have an effective vaccine for healthcare professionals and others for prevention of hepatitis C. So this was a huge discovery, and deserving of a Nobel. So this is the end of my talk. I don't know how much time I took, and I hope it was useful. I will end by a small video. You know, Sujit, I noticed that you had Penny talking about Penny in your promotional videos. It looks like you are a big fan of Big Bang Theory. So being Penny is one's choice. Of course, there are girls out there who would want to be like Penny. There's no problem at all. That's perfectly all right. And of course, there is an opportunity for so many girls to be like Penny and be interested in research. I don't know, in reality, this actress, I can't remember her name, who played Amy in this great series. She herself is a neuroscientist. And she played this great role of being a neuroscientist in this great series. So for all the girls out there, being into research is a great thing, and that culture has to be inculcated right from early years, right from school. Unfortunately, it is lacking in our educational curriculum in India, but I'm sure it's going to catch up. We are going through so much changes, and I'm sure that doing research is going to pick up. Medicine, I do not know how many of you, for medicine, my personal thoughts would be medicine, young people should get into medicine and medical research only if they are really interested, and if medicine is their calling, only then they should get into medicine. But research is something which is great, and it is open, and it has a lot of possibilities for all the young people out there. Thank you very much. I hope I was kind of useful.
Thank you so much. I mean, it was lovely. And thank you so much also for this passionate advocacy for a career in research. You know, I would completely agree with her, and completely second her on this. You know, this passion to discover and to explore the world of knowledge, to create knowledge, to discover stuff is something we have all benefited from. And that is something that we need to foster. In fact, the idea behind this series of talks on the Nobel Prizes was hopefully to foster an interest to be one of these discoverers, you know. And of course, one of the trivia, again, she mentioned many, is that historically the Nobel Prize has been given more for discoveries rather than inventions.
Yes.
And these discoveries have changed the way. And in fact, it was very interesting for me to know how you looked at this hepatitis C as a non-A, non-B thing.
Yeah.
And how prevalent it is.
It used to scare the surgeons a lot. So that was the time when we started doing the double gloving, this, that, because we knew that even if this patient has tested negative for HIV and HBS and hepatitis B, there is still something out there which can affect you.
And those of you who love detective fiction, you should love research, because research, for me, when I do research, I think of myself like an investigator, you know, very much like the Enid Blyton character that I used to try to be as a child, or as the Hardy Boys, Nancy Drew. In fact, that reminds me.
And research doesn't have to be science.
Yeah, exactly. But in any case, even in science, I think it is a mystery. You're trying to solve a mystery. So, yep. And you go into it as a, in fact, we had discussed that when we talked about the Nobel Prize in physics and chemistry, that this person was actually grew up on detective fiction, on and love for mystery and solving the mysteries. And in fact, on that note, if you attended the Nobel Prize in chemistry talk, we talked about how this year, for the first time, two women got the Nobel Prize in chemistry, whereas in the entire history, only five people earlier had got, only five women. So that is the changing world.
So women are doing great.
That she talked about women coming out, you know.
Women are doing great. And the only person who got it in physics was the lone physicist from UCLA, Andrea Ghez, you know, the physics laureate.
Yeah.
So women are definitely, they need opportunities, and research is something, you know, it has to, we have to have a paradigm shift in our educational policies and the curriculums. We have to get away from this. That's why I said it's not about reading and just reproducing it. That should be the aim of education.
And in fact, that is why I would request all of you who are watching this, because you have taken interest. You know that this will not be probably asked in your board exams or in your school exams, but you have taken this interest, and I'm very happy to see very young children also, you know, in class 3-4 also attending this, because you've written in the comments box. You know, it is important that you know, whatever you understood, it is fine. What is more important is that you have taken an attempt to try and know. You know, that is very important. And you can come back to this video, because the video will remain on YouTube, on Facebook, and you can come back to the video, whatever parts you did not understand, though it was very simple and very, but because many of you are very young, you can keep coming back to it for some information and insight. And definitely,
sorry, go on.
Yeah.
I just remember to say, you know, I feel so bad, because I have two daughters, and I have, you know, they've gone through school and everything. The projects and the research things that they are supposed to do, it really, they don't put their mind into it. And, you know, most of the projects are just made. I wish all these things would change for you, even if it's something small. Schools need to change their attitude and how they educate the children, the project works that they do. It's only for namesake. I mean, I hope I am not politically incorrect by saying all this.
No, completely. So that is the discussion we have tried to have in the course of the other lectures also. Because when we're talking about, you know, this, I think if we're talking about the Nobel Prizes and not talking about the kind of education that can create Nobel laureates from among our listeners, then we are failing our job.
The students go to the shops and just order a project and get it and submit it. So it's really, you know, that's not the way. And the fact is that India boasts of a huge, know-how or manpower in science. The only reason why we are not able to represent internationally or globally is because we don't inculcate the idea of research and publications and those things.
Absolutely.
That needs to...
In fact, I'll tell you something I feel sad about. It is funny. I remember some students of IIT Kanpur saying, you know, they had this talk about the BTECs, the MTECs and the PhDs. And they said that the products of IIT Kanpur are the BTECs, okay, the MTECs are the byproducts, and the PhDs are the waste products.
Oh my God.
So unfortunately, our IITs are also not, you know, they are great institutions. But yeah. I wish they had been better with research. You know,
all those who have the right minds, they are all going out. I mean, at least till now. Now I'm sure, Sujit, things are changing. Definitely things are changing. And higher education institutes are definitely coming up. And there's a lot of research and work going on in our country. There's no doubt about it. We are changing. Only thing is we need to change more.
Exactly.
And we need to change right from class one students.
Exactly. And I would repeat here, you know, that is why reading, exploring the world of knowledge beyond just the curriculum, beyond the textbook is so important. You know, doing the project reports that she talked about, instead of just going to a shop and getting it, projects are actually a wonderful way of getting into the world of discovery or doing something by yourself. So please, I would request all of you to make the most of it. And when the library reopens, you know, I thought, unfortunately, we don't have books on medicine, but we have some wonderful medical thrillers. Now, I'll show you some of the books. Now, can we have it full screen so that I can just show these books? Yeah. So, Amitav Ghosh is one of my favorite authors. And this is one of my favorite novels, Calcutta Chromosome, which is on the discovery of malaria. And it's a wonderful medical thriller. I would definitely recommend it to everyone here. Not for small children. That would be difficult, but this is a wonderful book. Another wonderful book I would recommend, which is at our library, is this book, which won the Pulitzer Award on the biography of cancer, called The Emperor of Maladies. So this is another wonderful book. This is by Siddharth Mukherjee. It won the Pulitzer Prize for nonfiction. And of course, Robin Cook, who has a series of medical thrillers, which all of you can read and find out. This Contagion, by the way, is not related to the movie Contagion, which was so eerily similar to our COVID experience. And one more thing, just I would like to share, it was interesting because she talked about the discovery of insulin. You know, we have been promoting the idea of gifting plants, and one of the plants which is very popular is called the insulin plant. Can we just see that? So that is actually the technical term.
Why is it called?
Because apparently it works in the same way. So the leaves, if you eat, it's a medicinal plant. It's called Coscidium, but popularly called the insulin plant.
Okay.
So you can actually gift plants, you know, those of you who are watching this, on any occasion, birthdays, wedding, any occasion, childbirth, you know, we say that a plant is the best gift to give because it's the only gift that grows. Let's get back. So I'm sure you can have your questions now. Let's see what questions we have. If you have not asked your question, you can type it in your comments box. Okay, there's a very young child who asked, what is DNA?
DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. It is the building block of all living things. Let's say it's life in very short terms. It is typically depicted by the double helix, and it was discovered by Watson and Crick. Which class is this student?
Must be a very young class, has not written.
So
DNA is life. This is from class 8, Eva. What is test tube baby? How and why they happen?
So test tube baby is a situation where doctors take the egg from the mother and the sperm from the father and fertilize it outside the body in a test tube, in a laboratory, and then culture it for about 3 to 5 days when early pregnancy is formed, a zygote and an early embryo is formed. And then that is again re-implanted back into the mother's uterus. So it is called test tube baby because usually the fertilization to create a life or to create a baby occurs inside the body in the fallopian tubes of the mother, of a woman. Now, in this situation, it is done outside the body, in the laboratory, not in a test tube, but it is done in a petri dish. So it is required for people whose tubes are damaged and they cannot fertilize the egg on their own. So this technology is required to help them to become pregnant.
So Anil is asking about insulin in a tablet form.
To the best of my knowledge, insulin as of now is not available in tablet form. But there is a lot of talk about it becoming available in the near future. But no, not now.
Okay. So there is this question about CT scan.
So CT scan is computerized tomography. Why it is done? It is done to image the body for detecting various diseases. Supposing somebody is coming with fever and cough, and when you do them an X-ray, you don't find or you cannot diagnose what the problem is. Or if you examine the patient with stethoscope, you cannot find what the diagnosis is. You may need to do a CT scan, and CT scan of the chest will show us in great detail how the lungs are, whether they are infected, whether they have a tumor or anything like that. Somebody has a pain in the abdomen and we are not able to find a cause. They have stomach pain regularly and doing other tests like ultrasound, X-ray is not making us find why they are having so much pain. A CT scan may be able to find small stones or some other conditions for which a patient is there. So this is a very important test, let us put it that way, that utilizes X-rays to detect various diseases and ailments in the body.
Okay. I think there is this question about if we have cancer in the liver, what will happen?
The question is very simple, but the answer is not very simple. So the easiest thing to say is that if somebody has liver cancer, they are not going to be able to digest their foods properly. They're going to lose weight. They're going to develop jaundice. They are probably going to also have pain around that side of the stomach. So many complex, complicated and multiple symptoms may be there. But the commonest may be loss of weight, not being able to eat, and developing jaundice.
So, can we take antibiotics of hepatitis A, B, C?
So, antibiotics, there are different kind of organisms that cause infectious diseases. Broadly, they are bacteria, virus, protozoa, fungi, broadly. Antibiotics are meant for bacterial diseases. Hepatitis A, B and C are all viral diseases. So for these, we need antiviral drugs, not antibiotics. For hepatitis A, usually the antivirals don't respond very well. But yes, for these three, maybe some antivirals may be useful in some situations.
So similarly for COVID, we are not really looking forward to antibiotics, but antiviral.
Antivirals, yes.
Yeah.
And those antivirals are also very empirical. We are not sure whether they are working.
Yeah. So I think the question, I think you've already in a way answered, but you can elaborate on that.
We have plenty of
an IVF baby in entire Eastern Odisha, right?
Yes. We were the first center. Yeah, we have plenty of facilities of IVF in Bhubaneswar.
Including your own hospital, our hospital.
Including our own hospital, right. So, you see, when I was doing my post-graduation, or let us say when I was doing MBBS, which was in 1984-85, and then post-graduation in 90-91, that time IVF was like a dream. Like today, how you are thinking about some novel thing which you have not seen, like traveling to space or something like that. So IVF was like that. Now, how much medicine has advanced that 30 years down the line, IVF has become a common practice, and even in places like Bhubaneswar, it is easily available.
I think there are a couple of people who are asking about hepatitis B. They want to know more. Snigdha is asking, and I don't know this, what is the name of Yo-Yo Warrior? He's also asking.
About hepatitis B?
Yeah.
Hepatitis B is a viral disease that affects the liver. Hepatitis, it causes infection of the liver, and it is transmitted through blood. Like you cannot, like COVID, how you get it through air, so it's airborne. That virus is airborne. Measles, etc., how you get through the air. And hepatitis A, you get through infective fluids, like you eat something, you drink something. So it's a, it goes through your gastrointestinal tract. Hepatitis B, one can get only through the blood or blood products. See, you know, like serum or blood products you can get. It is a, it's transmitted in a different way. And the risk, at-risk people are those patients who undergo any procedure in which their blood is exposed in a hospital if they are treated with an infective, by inadvertently through an infective needle or something like that. Those things rarely happen these days, but anyway, if that happens. And medical professionals who treat patients who are infected with hepatitis. There are many other ways you can get. You can get it through blood transfusion. But let's not go there. These are the common causes.
To Shreyans and Yo-Yo Warriors, I would suggest you can go back to this video again, because I think she spoke considerably about hepatitis C. So I can understand that maybe because it was all new to you, you want her to explain again. But I think, would you want to say, I think you can go back to the video, you know, after this ends. You can replay the video on YouTube or Facebook. You are seeing it on YouTube. So you can go back to the video on YouTube and see it again and replay it till you understand it.
Yeah.
So you can do that.
So hepatitis B are not very different. They are transmitted in the same manner. The problem with hepatitis C is that it is more chronic. It stays. It doesn't go away easily. And it lead, it over the years, it can lead to liver cancer. Hepatitis B can also, but hepatitis C is more sinister, you know, kind of.
Yeah. So, Sarita Pradhan, who has been an old patient of yours, you know, she had commented about, you know, seeing you after 14 years. Now, she has this question. I think it's a lifestyle question that a lot of people have. Popping a pill, a painkiller now and then, less pain and cramps is fine, but does it have any adverse effect?
So, analgesics or painkillers, as they are known, are available over the counter. You don't need a doctor's prescription to get it. And that is why it is one of the most abused drugs. So, I would please recommend not only Sarita, but everybody, that popping a pill now and then for pain is not a good idea at all. Because all medications have some side effect or the other. Anything as simple as taking a Crocin also can have side effects, because it has a massive effect on your gastric mucosa. And if you keep popping it over years, over many years, you are going to damage your stomach lining. And that can lead to ulcers and gastritis and so many things. Does it have any adverse effect? Yes, it has some adverse effect. Taking a pill is not the answer. Don't take painkillers regularly for any problem.
So I have to tell you something. So when my father, I mean, may he rest in peace, he was a very sweet person. He was very caring, but to the point where, you know, he insisted that we had vitamin C for breakfast when I was a child. And every day, almost, I would fall down, have a bruise. And then every other day, I would go for a tetanus. So much so that, you know, I would find the injection very sweet. So after that is the reason why I started running away from doctors and medicine after that. I think there are many questions.
Vitamin C and all that, you know, people don't sometimes also appreciate that taking extra those vitamins and supplements, those are also not a good idea. Because nature has almost everything. And most of the supplements you can take through natural things. You don't need supplements also like vitamin C and all that regularly at all, I feel.
Yeah. So I think, yeah. So there are many questions about, again, the same things that you've already talked about, Shreyans. Like, you had network problem. That is fine. But as I said, you know, the video is going to be there on YouTube and on Facebook. And in Instagram, we'll share it. So you can see it again there. You can go over it again and again. So unlike a physical talk, you know, that's the advantage of an online lecture. Unlike a physical talk, which ends with the speaker leaving, here that the recording is there for us to keep going back to it, you know, to understand. So I'll just take a question which is not related to what Dr. Kerr has already spoken. And that is from Sudhanya Roy. Is the structure of the virus, you know, does it differentiate them and how difficult it is to isolate them? You know?
So if you are asking whether the viruses are all different, yes, they are very, very different. They're very, very different. Again, I'm not a biologist. I mean, I'm a clinician. So I cannot give you exact details, but viruses are different types and they differ greatly. Even the COVID virus, which is now there over the last 1 year or so, since it has newly been discovered, it has undergone so many changes and so many mutations. So the structure of different viruses are very different and how difficult it is to isolate them. Question is, why would you want to isolate? If it is for research, it is difficult, but I think research people know the technique of isolating viruses.
But I think the isolation happens when you are researching on it anyway.
Yeah.
Isn't it? Yeah. I think with that, we will end today's session. We had a wonderful talk. And as I said, I request all of you, I'm really happy to see so many of you asking to repeat the point, because that means you're curious to know. You're trying to understand what is the thing. And as I said, the videos are there. You can go back to it. And if you want to know further, of course, you can Google, you can search. We'll have to end this somewhere. So we'll end it here. But before that, let me just remind you that this Saturday, we are traveling to Lebanon at 9 p.m. on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter in our story time at 9. And Sunday is Rabibar Gopabar. And this Sunday, for the first time, we have a couple. Now, isn't that a pretty picture? So there's Amir Patnaik and Savita Patnaik. Amir Bhai and Savita Bhai, who will be doing a storytelling in tandem. You know, they will do it together. So you have a double bonanza this Sunday in the Rabibar Gopabar. And then, of course, we have story time at 9 on Saturday. So thank you very much, Dr. Sujata Kar. It was wonderful. You know, it was just, you know, our prescription for the Nobel lectures was just what you did today. You know, make it interesting. You know, and this is what we wanted, that children should be curious to know more. And I think you've created that, you know, the thirst to know more, that hunger. I really hope that some of the people who view this, either live or subsequently, would actually develop an interest in research. Whether you dedicate a career to research or not, but any kind of research in what you do is something that is going to help all of us, everyone and mankind. So anything you would like to say before
we end? Sujit, thank you very much. I enjoyed myself a lot. And I hope that Bakul Foundation and you've been doing so much work. I mean, over the years, you remember, I have been in touch with you since my daughter was growing up. I have sent quite a few of books to your library, which my children, you know, threw all over the place. So I have known you since then, and you've grown so much. And now Bakul is almost international, what I see. I don't have any small children anymore. So maybe I'm not very connected with all the activities that you do, not so much, but I seem to see that you are growing leaps and bounds, and I hope you continue to do that, Sujit. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you so much. And but my goal is to reduce this growth in myself. I know you talked about obesity and the medical problems. So that is something, of course, which is a goal that for myself.
One of my favorite topics is obesity in school going and young people. So we can talk about it.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you everyone for joining us.
Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye.
You know, in education that we are trying to promote reading. As statistics say, 50% children in grade 5 cannot read the textbook of grade 2, then what is really happening? That's because the basic skills of reading and writing is not there. So we thought that if we have to change this cynicism, then we need to demonstrate what is possible with small contributions. So that is the idea basically that Bakul is trying to demonstrate, what is possible entirely with volunteerism, entirely with small little contributions. We asked people to contribute books to set up a public library in Bhubaneswar, and a children's library was set up in Bhubaneswar, and now that children's library has become a general library, a public library with more than 20,000 books. So that is one of the major things. Another major area of intervention is environment. A lot of environmental education, but through films and through creative methods. So we have a traveling film festival on environment. We go to schools, colleges, apartments and screen films on environment, primarily on climate change and on issues of water and sanitation, two issues that we're working in. And at the libraries also, we conduct a lot of workshops on creativity. You know, we all want the world to be a better place, and we have our own ideas of how it can be better. The thing is, can we all start in some small way towards addressing that? Can we say that in some small way, this world is the way I want it to be because I have done something about it?